Setting up your projects with your preferred settings is kind of important, right? I mean, everyone has slightly different ways that they want to build their cabinets, and sometimes you'll have projects that call out for different specs than the majority of the rest of your jobs. So getting the products from your library into your toolbox project is one thing, but what if they're like real jobs? In this video, we're going to go through how to use some of the properties in the global variables and the material file to make the drafting and engineering process more efficient, and to make sure what we're actually sending from the office is going to work when it goes out into production. So for this, let's go back into our ShopGrade cabinets and get into some more deeper level changes that you can make to your projects. Now, the changes we do at the project level can also be done in your template, so all future projects can be set up the same way. Okay, enough talk. Let's get back into that project and keep learning more about Toolbox. Okay, so here we are back into our ShopGrade cabinets project, and let's make sure that our current room is my shop. Okay, so the first thing we're going to do is go back into our global variables to make some changes in our project that are a little bit deeper than just some of those project wizard settings. The changes that we're going to be making here are for the project level, so all these cabinets that we already have drawn are going to accept these same changes as well. Now, we're not going to redraw these cabinets. We're going to start fresh and draw a couple new ones and go through some of the different changes that we're making here. So the first thing that I want to point out is the disable wizard variables. Having this unchecked allows you to use the project wizard. Otherwise, you'd have to make all your changes inside of the global variable. Let's go through those different variables below. By checking these, we'll be able to have the different tabs show up on our products when we open up our prompts page. So instead of checking construction or advanced or material options every time in our prompts, they'll automatically be on for us. So currently we have our countertop depth under our base cabinet setting. Now that's not something we can change inside of our project wizard. That's only here in the global variables. So we would go into our countertop depth, and if we wanted to make the change, we could select it and see why this value is coming in at 26. So currently this is a formula. And like I said before, formulas are not something that we want to overwrite. So this one is reading base cabinet depth plus countertop front overhang. So it's basically just a math equation taking those two values and giving us this countertop depth. So to change that, we'll find that variable countertop front overhang. You'll see there, we have a formula, but it is just a conversion formula, so that's okay, we can overwrite that. Let's give that a value of 1. And to confirm, you can hit the refresh button here. So if you want to, go ahead and hit refresh on your end, and you'll see the countertop depth change from 26 to its new value. In the tall and upper cabinet, if you wanted to make any changes in there, you also can go through and check out some of those different settings. And then once we change anything in here, it's always a good idea to go and draw a cabinet, check it out in 3D, see what's happening. You know, whatever we see inside of that drawing is most likely what's going to go out to the shop. So if we see something funny, just double check to make sure everything's working the right way. Okay, now moving on to the library construction tab. So this is the area where you're going to have a lot more control on how your products are going to be built. And also some of those details that really matter as you're assembling everything, and especially as it comes time for installation. First, let's make sure that we have some scribe turned on our finished ends. So currently we have this set to 0, and that's why we need to turn it on when we're inside of the product at the local level. But we can change that here. So when we have a finished end turned on our product, we can have an additional scribe added to the backside. Make sure the installers have what they need to scribe to all those terrible walls that we're always dealing with. And then set that to 1/2 inch or even more, depending on how you like it to be set up. I'm going to change this hanger notch width also. So instead of it being 4 inches, I want to give ourselves a little more tolerance. So if you're using like a 4-inch cleat, maybe a wider notch would be good for you. So 5 inches, I'm going to set this one to. So depending on your nailer width size, we'll also determine, you know, how far you want that to be located from the top of your cabinet. Now onto our drawer stretchers. I'm going to change this to lock drawers. You can see we have the other options in there as well, but save on a little bit of material. So if there's no locks on my drawer cabinets, I don't need to have a drawer stretcher. And again, we're just going through the process here, showing you where everything is, how you can make some changes inside of the global variables. Of course, you're going to be setting them up to what best suits your needs, but just going through the motions. Now into our panel reveals. So we're going to start off with the base top gap. So this is going to be the distance down from the top of our cabinet to the top of our drawer front or door. Setting it to 7/8, that'll allow for a front overhang to come over the face of that cabinet box. Now for the shelf settings, here you find different shelf settings for adjustable and fixed shelves. We're going to check the box to make a continuous shelf hole or a full line bore. So currently it's just set up to have a hole pattern. I'm going to turn that on full system holes all the way up. Okay, now we hit okay. We've saved those global variables. We're back into our drawing. Now, rather than just redrawing these cabinets and taking a look at them, we could do that, but I'm going to just add some new ones here, make it a little bit easier. Change our view back into a wireframe. We don't want to be drafting inside of a conceptual or realistic. It'll just take too long. So change that view. Now let's add a construction line, you know, separate our work here. So now let's draw a 5-foot wall, just a straight wall, add a couple products to it, and we can see how they're being drawn based on the changes that we just made to the global variables. Go ahead and place that wall in model space and give it a value of 60. Yeah, so we're going to go with a drawer stack since we made some changes to our drawer settings or drawer stretcher settings. Let's turn on that finished end so we can double check our scribe. Now notice below those construction and advanced options are on. So we don't have to worry about turning that on every time we open up this prompt page. Tabs are appearing, so that's how it works from the global variables down to the product. Inside of the construction options, there we see our finished end scribe does have a half an inch. Double check the top reveal and the face options, and that's how that works. All that's coming in from the global variables. Our products are looking to those settings, and this is also why it's very important to keep some of those formulas that are red intact, because if you do overwrite those, then things that we're doing inside the project wizard or the global variables just don't matter. They're not going to be able to tell the products how to behave. All right, now remember we had the add countertop to our products global variable turned off in our previous video. So now we don't have a countertop on just this one product. So we'll need to add a separate one from our library. So let's do that and just anchor it on the center of the wall. Now we have that set up to the depth that we had in our globals at 25. Now with an upper, let's get a two-door upper on that wall. Here we're just double checking to make sure all those global variables are working inside of the products. Make it a little bit easier just to focus on these cabinets here. We're going to isolate the objects. So first, let's dig into that base cabinet a little bit. Change our view again to a left so we can see how those drawer stretchers have been turned off. There's our base top gap at 7/8. So if there was a front edge of a countertop that needed to be drawn in there, we don't have any conflict now with our top drawer. And now into the upper cabinet, see we have the continuous shelf holes or full line board, and also the hanger notch width updated to 5 inches. And if you have a job that requires some of those special inserts for adjustable shelf pins, you can increase the diameter of that hole also. You can go back into our global variables and I'll show you how we can do that. Under the library construction, under shelf settings again. So first we'll turn off the continuous shelf hole. And then just updating your quantity to whatever you want. If you want it to be a 7-hole pattern or 3-hole pattern, you can do that. And just making sure, again, we're always hitting OK after we enter a new value in that text box. And then going back and redrawing your product. So there we got a 7-mil hole, 3-hole pattern. And so that's one way that you can change how adjustable shelves will be set up in your products. Now, the next thing I want to talk about is the material that we're using for this job. So this was the 3/4 plywood that we had set up in our previous video. That's currently set up as a true 3/4 thickness. I don't know where you get your plywood, but where I would get mine, it was never true 3/4, and it was never consistent either. Just double check the thickness. Once you have that confirmed, you can come back into Toolbox and be sure that it knows exactly what thickness of material you have out in the shop. So let's go through the process of how we would do that. Now you have two ways to edit the material. One being inside of the template, doing it there, or copying a material from the project level and having that material be specific to the project. So this is the current material that we're going to make a copy of. And if you're not sure where it's at inside of the material library, under those folders, you can right click, go to find selected material. And that takes you right to it inside of that plywood folder. We now have our 3/4 plywood. Right click and copy that selection to the project level. So that's just asking you how many times you want to copy it, just once. Because now I have the option to edit it by either double clicking or right click to show that menu. And I'm going to give it a unique name. I like to do that so there's no confusion with Toolbox thinking that it's trying to use a material that already exists in the library. So just give it a unique name. We'll call it shop grade birch plywood. And just because we have the 11/16 in the name of this material, Toolbox doesn't know that's the actual thickness. So you still got to go into the thickness field and make sure you update that there. Let's enter our true 11/16. Now I can show all this material by groups again, by right clicking and showing groups. But just in case there's a part inside of one of these products that's not in this group and it's still looking to that 3/4 material, I'm going to do it a different way and just filter everything by the current material. And now everything that's 3/4 plywood, I have it all together. I can highlight them all and reassign all those parts using this new project level material, shop grade birch plywood. Now let's redraw that cabinet. Use the distance command again, double check our left side thickness. And that looks good. And now what Toolbox is doing is taking into consideration the thickness of both the left and right side, and then making our top and bottom shelf the correct width to give us the overall width that we need. It's smart enough to do all that math for us in the background and also to make sure it keeps all that machining intact. Now, the next part of this video, I want to go back into the material file and talk a little bit more about pointer groups. So because we've been working with our countertops a little bit, I thought this would be a good one to show you how we can set something up that currently doesn't live inside of a pointer group and give it a new home. So that's what we're going to do with our countertop parts. Into the material file. Now we can show groups, and you can see here that it does not have its own pointer group. So right clicking in the open space, now next to groups, go to edit groups. And here we have the option to edit material pointer groups. Right click again, and that'll bring up some options. We can enter a new group name. Now it's just a matter of selecting the different material pointers to put inside of that group. So we have a countertop pointer name, we got countertop buildup. Those are really the only two inside of the material file right now. And then once you've assigned those the same way that you would assign a material to a pointer name, and double checking to make sure they're inside of that group, there they are. Now we have our group countertops, and we can change the material that's going to be used for the countertops and that countertop buildup. So if we want to change it to a white melamine, find our 3/4 white melamine, two-sided, and assign that new material. Now back into our drawing, let's redraw that countertop. Let's go into the prompts of the countertop, and now we can show the material options, but it's a good way just to see what material it is that you're working with. And same thing for the upper cabinet, you can double check all the different material that's being used there. Now, if something doesn't look right, you would just go back into the material file and make the change there to update it to the material that it needs to be. Or if it's just this cabinet and not the entire project, you can go ahead and change it right here inside of the product. Well, hopefully now after that training session, you feel a little more comfortable going into your projects and making sure that they're all set up exactly the way that you need them to be as you get ready to send these jobs out to production. Coming up in our next few videos, we'll be going over that process of taking a job from start to finish. So stay tuned, and I'll see you next time for some more learning.